42 सर।
ओके फाइन। सो इन 1967 an original article entitled infantile acute febrile mucocutaneous lymph node syndrome clinical observations of 50 cases was published by a Japanese clinician in the Journal of Allergy. So it was a Japanese publication with English abstracts. So this was based on 7 years of observation of 50 cases, which he found to be something new, something not what he had seen before or read in any textbooks. And this laid the foundation of the so-called Kawasaki disease. In 2002, this original article was translated into English. Jane Burns, who happens to be one of the most prolific publishers and one of the most knowledgeable persons globally on the subject, and who happened to be also one of the translators, commented in his exhaustive detailing of every observable aspect of the disease, Kawasaki was part Sherlock Holmes and part Charles Dickens, with his sense of mystery and his vivid descriptions of the clinical features of these patients. So you can understand the detailing that he had described in his original article. So diagnosis, this is the American guidelines that came out in 2017. So a child with fever for 5 days, of course, again, that 5 days is presently arbitrary, because even an astute clinician with the classical findings can diagnose Kawasaki with a fever of 3 to 4 days. And the classic findings are erythema and cracking of the lips, strawberry tongue, and or erythema of the oral and pharyngeal mucosa. Bilateral bulbar conjunctival injection without exudation. So it's a dry conjunctivitis, a rash. It can be of any form except a bullous lesion or a vesicular lesion. Erythema and edema of the hands and feet in the acute phase, and or periungual desquamation in the subacute phase, and finally a cervical lymphadenopathy, which is usually unilateral. So since it's a visual presentation, so we will have a look at some of the pictures. So I think pediatricians can really make a diagnosis very astutely in these patients. A young child presenting with the non-purulent bulbar conjunctivitis, the mucositis, the edema of the hands and feet, and this rash. You can have almost any form of rash except, as we said, vesicular rash or a pustular rash. So it can be of any form. Look at these rashes, almost erythema forming, erythrodermal like. So you can have a variety of rashes in AD. So these are all rashes in patients of Kawasaki disease. A certain thing which has not been very acutely described is the perineal desquamation. So we have the periungual classical desquamation, but preceding the periungual desquamation, you have the perineal desquamation. So one has to look for this perineal desquamation and cervical lymphadenopathy. So occasionally it has been described the cervical lymphadenopathy can mimic a suppurative lymphadenitis. You can see the redness and the swelling and the tenderness in these patients. And this is something that has been lately described. So this is what you call a retropharyngeal phlegmon. So you can see the edema over here on the MRI plate in the retropharyngeal space. So this is another presentation of Kawasaki disease with a retropharyngeal phlegmon. A very interesting finding, and this is almost pathognomic of the disease, is the reactivation of the BCG scar present in around 10 to 15% of the patients. So if you have a reactivation, it's almost pathognomic of the diagnosis of Kawasaki disease. This is an interesting finding that we had described, color changes in the nails. So there is a orange-brown coloration of the nails that we first described as a case series in pediatric in Rheumatology International in 2011. And subsequently, it has been described globally. And this is the final publication that we had just a month back, 10 years since the original publication. So the Indian Journal of Pediatric Dermatology. So this is presented almost 60 to 65% of the patients. And this is something which appears in the acute phase and stays for a substantial amount of time. So please look at the nails. You can come across this finding. Now, classical Kawasaki, I think most of the pediatricians can now almost diagnose with certainty a patient with classical Kawasaki. But occasionally, in almost 20 to 30% of the patients, you will find something which is, you don't have the classical features, that is known as the incomplete Kawasaki disease. So these are the American guidelines again. So children with fever or two or three compatible clinical criteria. So you do not have the all the five features, you have some features, or infants with fever for 7 days without other explanation. So this is a very, very important category. An infant with a pyrexia of unknown onset without any other features can again be a Kawasaki disease. So you have to look the laboratory tests at that time. So a raised CRP, a raised ESR, and then some of the laboratory findings that anemia, unexplained anemia, unexplained thrombocytosis. So this is one of the very important things that you need to look whenever you are looking at a patient with unexplained fever. A platelet count is often ignored. Sometimes a lot of labs, they do not report the platelet count. They just said it's adequate. So it's not adequate. You have to ask for the platelet count. And an unexplained thrombocytosis should always be a pointer towards a Kawasaki in any other, if it is not unexplained. A low albumin, ALT levels, leukocytosis with neutrophilic leukocytosis. And occasionally, you can have a sterile pyuria. We have encountered patients of Kawasaki disease being treated as UTI. And definitely, the echocardiography finally helps in solving the diagnosis. So these are some of our experiences. In unusual presentations, nephrotic syndrome, macrophage activation syndrome occasionally we have encountered. This was a patient with bilateral ptosis. On receiving IVIG, you can see the improvement in this baby. This was an infant with Kawasaki disease. This was rather a neonate, a 22-day-old baby who had presented with fever for 7 days, the mucositis, the rashes, and the unexplained edema. And there were giant aneurysms over here, you can see on the echocardiography. So this is one of the earliest reported patients of Kawasaki disease, a 22-day-old baby. Shock syndrome. So this is one of the recent presentations, myocarditis and shock syndrome. So presenting with hypotension, with very high inflammatory markers, and occasionally multi-organ dysfunction. And these are the patients, usually they end up in the PICUs. So the intensivist should be aware of this condition, an unexplained shock in a child. So think of Kawasaki, think of a myocarditis. So this was a 2-month-old baby with the fever for 15 days, no other finding, just an unexplained thrombocytosis. And this baby had giant aneurysms, multiple giant aneurysms, including a thrombus in one of the aneurysms. And this was again the sad story of a child who presented with fever, incomplete Kawasaki, infancy. The fever subsided. So Kawasaki, we all know, is a self-limiting vasculitis. Even untreated, the fever may subside by about 15 days. And this child subsequently presented with a swelling in the axilla. It was diagnosed to be lymphadenopathy, but then the person who did the USG said it's a vascular swelling, and you can see the giant aneurysms in the axillary artery along with the aneurysms in the iliac arteries. So a Kawasaki disease with multiple giant aneurysms in some of the big arteries. So what is not Kawasaki disease? A lot of infections can mimic Kawasaki disease, especially the streptococcal and the staphylococcal infections with their toxin features. Steven Johnson, serum sickness. So this was a child who presented with features like Kawasaki disease, but had a big pneumonia. So this was a pneumonia mimicking Kawasaki disease. Another patient presenting with Kawasaki-like features, but only there was an abscess in the labia. So it was a toxin-mediated feature of Kawasaki. Scrub typhus can present with features of Kawasaki disease. Sometimes it's very difficult to really distinguish but one of the pointers is a low platelet count. Scrub usually has a normal to lowish platelet count. And majority of the patients of scrub, they have some encephalopathy-like features, rather drowsiness. In KD, it is more of an irritability. Occasionally, you encounter systemic arthritis, which mimics Kawasaki. So a patient, usually they're infants or toddlers, presenting with fever and raised inflammatory markers. Occasionally arthritis, 10 to 15%, so 15% of patients of KD can present with arthritis. The ECO may show transient coronary dilatations, and they are usually IVIG resistant. So why identify KD? We said that it's a self-limiting vasculitis, but untreated, almost 20 to 25% incidence of coronary artery aneurysms. Remember, it is the commonest cause of myocardial infarction in children, and majority of MI occurs in the first year of onset with a mortality of 20% because MI in children is difficult. It's very difficult to diagnose. So distribution of the arthritis, it is usually a medium vessel disease, and somehow or the other, the coronaries are the most commonly affected. So just someone asked about the histological characteristics. It's the medium-sized arteries, and very important is a synchronous affection throughout the body. So there's no mixture of acute and chronic lesions. It's like a storm. And the majority, they have a macrophage and the neutrophils are the main components of the infiltrating cells. And there's no fibrinoid necrosis, there's no immune deposits. So just look at the morphogenesis. So it starts off as an edematous dissociation of the tunica media around the 6 to 8 days and progresses to aneurysm formation by around 12 days. So peak coronary dilatation occurs at an average of 14 to 15 days from the onset of fever. Among patients with a normal initial ECO, 10.2% recorded an abnormal follow-up ECO. So that is the importance of the follow-up ECOs. Among those with abnormal initial ECO, 27 to 32% experienced an increase in the Z-score at follow-up. Of all patients with dilatation at the convalescent phase, 23% had normal initial ECO. So that is the importance of follow-up of these patients. So one should follow up these patients definitely by echocardiography. And a normal ECO diagnosis does not rule out a subsequent involvement. The goals of therapy, control of the acute inflammation and prevent long-term sequelae. The treatment is standardized, intravenous immunoglobulin, 2 grams per kg, along with aspirin. So the dose of aspirin, presently, most of the centers have moved away from the higher doses. So it's either 30 to 50 mg per kg, and some of the centers are even using the antiplatelet dose of aspirin from the very beginning. So timing of IVIG, so that remains controversial. As soon as you diagnose, give the IVIG. Kawasaki is a clinical diagnosis. Even if you cannot do an echocardiography diagnosis, and remember that echocardiography should ideally be done by a pediatric cardiologist, because otherwise the coronary involvement is missed. So the timing should be as fast as possible, preferably within the first 10 days, but there's nothing sanctum about this 10 days. So if a patient even presents late, but with persistent fever, raised inflammatory markers, do not hesitate to administer the disease, administer IVIG. And it reduces the incidence of CA to 1 to 5%, and usually very, very prompt defervescence. So if a patient does not respond, the IVIG non-responders, 10 to 15% of patients will not respond to the first dose of IVIG. So the options are, you give a second dose, but again, 30% will not respond to the second dose. Pulse methylprednisolone, 30 mg per kg per dose for 1 to 3 days, and infliximab. We at our center are presently using infliximab for the last 3 years. So, and there's a lot of data now, real world data, which shows that infliximab is a good therapy. It's a safe and effective drug for treatment of IVIG refractory KD. So steroids role was always controversial, but presently since the publication of the RAISE study in Lancet, so this is steroids are also part of the protocol. So addition of prednisolone to the standard regimen of intravenous immunoglobulin improves coronary artery outcome in patients with severe coronary artery disease. And this was a publication in last year from if a patient presents with aneurysms at diagnosis. So over there, you have to intensify the treatment along with IVIG. You have to give either infliximab or corticosteroids. So just a word from Professor Surjit Singh, what he wrote in Indian Pediatrics. To the uninitiated, the diagnosis of KD may seem like an enigma. There seems to be more of art than science in arriving at a diagnosis. KD remains a purely clinical diagnosis and for the hardcore clinician. It cannot be overemphasized that the diagnosis rests on the recognition of a typical temporal sequence of a constellation of clinical features, with none of the features taken individually being of any diagnostic significance whatsoever. So any child with fever and the classical features, infants with disproportionate irritability and persistent cry, remember that can be a presentation of KD, infant with PVO, fever with unexplained thrombocytosis, raised inflammatory markers, a child with unexplained shock, cervical lymphadenopathy with rashes, and I think the list goes on. Think of Kawasaki disease. You have to think of the disease to diagnose the disease. So this is some of the pictures from our Indian delegates at the Kawasaki disease, the 12th International Kawasaki Disease Symposium 2 years back in Yokohama, Japan in 2018. You can see some of the luminaries, including Professor Surjit Singh, who's I think can be considered as our Indian Kawasaki. And this is my fanboy picture with the great man. So before I end my presentation, just a word from Kawasaki, Dr. Kawasaki. Be strict and sincere to medicine. Be kind to heartwarming to patients. And reading textbooks and papers is important, but seeing patient carefully is much more important. Thank you. Thank you.